welcome everyone to this conversation about chapters 4 and 5 in the book Numbskull. We've got myself and Hilary Bradbury and Cara Miller to speak a little bit at the beginning and then to answer your questions and comments at the second half of the program. And today we're looking at both chapters 4 and 5 of this peculiar book called Numbskull, whose title is meant to highlight the fact that we got to listen to the negative feedback we get as well as the positive feedback, and we may even discover some interesting things, as I have, about being a numbskull. But chapter 4 begins with my being an associate director of the Yale Summer High School and going to a class taught by a friend of mine, Morris Kaplan, and I experienced something in that class that I had not known was available as a possibility before that. And Hilary is going to say something about that in a few moments. But then in chapter 4, we also find me joining the Gurdjieff work, spiritual work that I was a member of that institution for 25 years. And then also joining a lot of group dynamics, different group dynamics, second person research, the Gurdjieff work being perhaps first person research. And also joining a PhD program a year after I had graduated, which was a kind of a third person research. So I had all three of these kinds of practices I was beginning. And just to test things out, I decided to start the Yale Upward Bound program, where I could see whether my first person, second person, and third person research helped anyone. So we got the Yale Upward Bound grant, and then we began having meetings with advisors and potential staff members. And one of the experiences I had was of how typical it is for me to try to avoid conflict. And as the book goes on, we see me facing conflicts which I'm reluctant to face, and having to learn again and again this double loop learning, which didn't take full root easily, about the importance and significance of my having the courage and just the awareness to look down at my own anger or disappointment or whatever it was on my end that was indicating there was a conflict.
Well, first of all, thank you for having me and to acknowledge my excitement, anticipation, heart beating here. I think when I read those chapters, the first thing of a number of things that popped out was the little vignette of you with Morris in a classroom that your friend Morris was hosting, teaching, facilitating. And as I understand it, they were teaching about Kafka, the trial, which is really about citizens, as we are today, often feeling completely unable to participate, getting lost, being ignored. And he was teaching in such a way that at least one of the students who kept putting up his hand was being ignored. And, you know, you could say, oh, bad teacher, but in fact, it was just a wonderful moment of teaching by doing, experimenting, and then allowing, encouraging the student to figure out, to bring awareness to what was actually happening. And I read that, because of the many things you could choose to put in your book or not, I read that as a kind of a seed of something that I think is enormously important in immersive action research, which is truly taking or finding the path between being, you know, inviting awareness to our work, acting such that there's good results. But this pathway through is this learning orientation that happens when we bring these two things together.
If your early story about being in the class with Morris was your first foray into being able to consult to what's happening in the now. So you see something as it's occurring and you take the chance to call on it, to call it out, to make observations about it. it seems to me that later in the story was when you started to take the opportunity to actually influence it from within the situation. So you were moving there, which I think is helpful around the developmental stage that you were moving to, from consulting to something, making your observations and offering those, to consulting or collaborating within the scenario, and that your, you know, developmental transitioning was reflective of that move. So that the stories about creating the learning environment or influencing the learning environment from within it was also reflective of the moves you were making in your understanding of power around what is my power unilateral, where I'm gonna you know, avoid conflict or help a system avoid conflict, or is my power going to be less unilateral and as the director or preventer and move towards the orchestrator or the influencer, so that conflict actually emerges with your direction and with your collaboration. So the conflict can use the power you have in your role to actually produce something more, more for the learning environment.
And now maybe I could ask each of you to take a turn saying something about your experiences and whether it was in any way as immersive as I found was necessary to teach me something at this level. But I am a numbskull, so I am hard to teach things. So Hilary, do you relate to this in some aspect of you?
I relate to being a numbskull, you know. and maybe one little way of framing this that I find helpful, yeah, inside the stages is how these stages are often, all of them, alive at particular moments or particular, you know, pieces of work that we're doing. So a few years ago, I began to turn my attention with great dedication to a foundation to raise consciousness, actually, about immersive action research. And that, in a way, is very much a transforming, or at least has capacity to be a transforming stage for all involved. You see, sometimes I work a little bit like a lighthouse. You know, the unilateral, the one who sees and witnesses and responds and enacts, is still like the master of the lighthouse. So what does it really mean to create and operate with others? So I think that's fundamentally the question at the transforming stage.
Similarly, I was in a system that felt like it was threatening to either shove me over into this unilateral lighthouse director space, or it was going to allow me the opportunity to open up and learn what it meant to be participatory as a leader and what it meant to be collaborative with the power that I was given in my role. And specifically, that was how to address the issue of low student engagement as a university professor. So across the board, we found in the cohort that we were teaching that they were less and less looking to self-author their own learning or to influence horizontally their own peers or their own teams. And more they were looking to be socialized, to be led, to be given expectations that they could just follow and conform to. And so if our challenge was to teach a form of leadership that was more participatory, that allowed opportunities for people to begin to self-authorize, begin to understand themselves as constructors of their own meaning, action inquiry, the ability to inquire into our action more and more in real time, moved from just a research practice, a way to research what we were doing, into a leadership and spiritual, personal leadership practice. So moving from a way to research us, ourselves as a group, to a way to lead ourselves as a group individually, but then ended up taking this expression of we can lead the actual group event using these principles. So not only can I show up as a more collaborative leader first person, but I can facilitate us showing up in a more collaborative form of leadership. And so the challenge for me as the professor was to create a learning environment and to introduce the questions and principles that brought awareness to the ways that we were socialized to hold our influence, to let others lead or set expectations for us. So rather than directing people how to study themselves, we actually invited ourselves to study ourselves. So I moved, you know, from understanding myself as the director or the lighthouse or the one who was going to put the learning on the group, to, you know, in the last iteration of the course, understanding myself as an instrument, as a container, using the authority that had been given to me, to be the place where people could actually become a community that could inquire about its own work and its own learning, inquire about the ways that they influenced across that container. And that felt like the most integrated and the most reflective practice of teaching I had ever experienced. And I started to see the ways, with Bill's and others' help, that I was really trying to liberate myself from the learning structures that had been put upon me. And the professors and coaches and authority figures who had espoused this non-unilateral or this collaborative type of power and learning, but that it wasn't present in the practice, and that that's really what I was longing to taste.
These experiences I had at Upward Bound were so totally immersive. It seems to me that that is really almost an absolute necessity for development to the later stages, full development. One can enter the transforming action logic partly just through cognitively and gaining some sense of how people's lives evolve and organizations evolve, but all of that is sort of outside learning if you're reading and so forth.
I'm really interested on these kind of connections between, you know, first person, but really how first person is a conversation in our own heads, in part with other people and in part with our past experiences and in part thinking about how we can better fit in and connect to other people. And I see you coming to the conclusion after a long career about the numbskull nature of so much of what we do. And so I guess I'm just curious about advice that you could give on how do we become, I guess, more effective in the way that we can think of the connections between our first person selves, our numbskull selves, our non-numbskull selves, and how we can get some of this learning awareness earlier in our careers in ways that are fruitful and that help other people as well become more reflective about how they're relating to each other and how that connects to their first person as well.
Where do we bring our first person? Where does our first person find expression if it doesn't have a second person place or loop? Then our loop remains very tight and right in here. So opening up that loop, requiring vulnerability and some agreements and some compassion, I think is, you know, one of the really beautiful things that Bill has been able to talk more about. And in Bill and Hillary's recent book together have talked about how do we take the first person loop and loop and loop and loop and really open it up to another loop with someone else to understand where does my first person meet your first person and what's the space between, how much is possible for us to create and sustain there. And from that place, we find a richer expression to loop out into third person places, the organizations we live in, the communities that we participate in, and really the large global organizations we claim to be citizens of.
The lifting up of suffering or conflict or, yeah, like we're so trained to turn away from it. It's so aversive to us. And it's not the only way to learn, but I think it's enormously important. So turning to the darkness, bringing light out of the darkness. And I think the way we do that, oddly enough, is by being more kind to ourselves. That allows us embrace conflict and turn it into something more beautiful.
I think, you know, one of the places that I represent now is more corporate organizations. When you are a member of a system, an existing system, organization, company, university, whatever it is, and you start to grow and change, your sense-making starts to become more inquiring. Your practice of leadership starts to become more collaborative, and the system, frankly, doesn't know what to do with you because you've expanded or had this experience of growth. So some of the leaders that I meet in organizations are in this inflection point where they're gaining new capacity and they're looking at their power as more of a mutual economy of power that they're participating in, rather than I have the power, I do the thing, right? And then I get the results, and the system likes me for it or rewards me for it. But now it's my responsibility to translate some of this for the rest of the organization, for the larger context. And that leaders often, you know, that I meet are coming up against that conversation. So having a coach like me, or having, you know, some pieces of reading that help them to take on that role of how do I translate my own growth and its benefit to myself and to others and then to the system.
I'm curious about whether we're talking about in a classroom with a team or within an organization, an immersive experience and bringing in all developmental stages, because what I've witnessed and find is that people can get lost on either end, where if all of a sudden there's a shift to more collaborative power when people have only been used to and socialized and, you know, responsive to unilateral power, the resistance sort of that Cara was speaking to arises, and they're like, oh, you know, what's happening here? And there can be kind of an uprising of someone ought to take control. and then also, you know, when you have a big spectrum of developmental levels, how do you not lose the people that are ready for something more dynamic? So however that serves in this moment, I just have a lot of curiosities about that and what you all have learned through your experiences.
Well, one two-word answer, which will lead into next time's event, is liberating disciplines. How do you create organizational structures that people at different developmental levels can feel somewhat comfortable in, yet also somewhat challenged in? And we will be approaching those questions next time. Thank you so, so much, everybody who came, and take care, everybody.